Hi, I'm Shari. I'm a PhD candidate and a popular music scholar, and today I'm going to react to Ariana Grande's new album, Eternal Sunshine. So I feel like before we talk about this album, we have to bring up the elephant in the room, or the fact that the elephant was married with a calf. Yeah, I would love that to not be the like narrative about this album, the like extramarital affairs like a woman was having. I'm not sure we'd care as much about the narrative if it was about a man, but I don't know. I still think it's an interesting point to think about, how she has been processing these things over the last several months, processing being in the news every day and being villainized by people who think they know a lot about your business but probably don't and shouldn't. So let's get started. This is such an interesting sound for Ariana. I feel like it's going back to like her first or second album, and like Put Your Hearts Up, that one, which is an album I really liked. It came out when I was in high school, but I remember her really describing that she did not like it. But it's like much softer. It's coming from a softer place, maybe even a place of victimhood, which again is really interesting in the like this idea of building a narrative through an album. Let's continue. If you're like an Ariana Grande fan and you really understand the hurricanes, comment down below. It's really interesting. Favorite thing about Ariana when she uses her head voice, but she adds a little bit of breath behind it. It adds like a delicateness. And somehow it feels more authentic here. Ooh, seeing the credits written at the end of the song here reminded me that this is supposed to be the first album that Ariana is like one of the songwriters on. Obviously she's written her own songs before, but this is the first album that she's a credited songwriter on every single track. That's a weird conversation in this industry, this sort of idea of authenticity, that you're more or less authentic if you're singing your own pieces versus if you're singing pieces you've written by yourself. Which is really interesting. I feel like Ariana has a lot more to offer with her talent, that we don't necessarily need to prove her authenticity or her like deserving to be in this space. I don't know. I mean, do I know? Who knows? Whatever. You know, this is like really interesting to me. She's not using a lot of her chest voice in this album. She's like really sticking up there in her head voice and adding a lot of breathiness. And I know she, like we know she's capable of singing like down in her chest and making it sound a lot stronger. Like it's a dedicated choice to make it sound like this. We've been seeing this like narrative rolling around that she's like dropped her black scent. Her like visuals are very clearly distinct from what they have been in the last like 10 or so years of her career. And I feel like when we're aligning artists with whiteness, we start to think about like their perception of victimhood versus, I don't know, who's in the right and wrong. And not to be like moralistic again, because like Ariana certainly doesn't deserve for like making this mistake to be like what carries around the rest of her career, but like, it feels very weird to be like writing an album and positioning yourself in what a victimhood when you and he certainly did something morally, if not ethically, wrong. And certainly you can have been hurt by it, but you're in like a lot of power to be able to put out an album and talk about how much you hurt after breaking up a marriage.
Okay.
if that's the spoken voice or if they are like who should be credited for that little interlude. That's a really interesting perspective to add on to this, the like, rather than like seeing yourself as a place of victim, but like you're just in generally a bad place and you start doing really destructive things. And now you're like coming to terms with this, like, you can't keep doing all of this destructive like you have to move on and grow up and like be who you are. But like, I don't know, I feel like I'm not really buying it. She's in her 30s, and in every like interview we've seen about this subject, God, I promised that this wasn't going to be about the affair of it all, but like it sort of is also like too. I don't know, I don't really believe in that whole separate the art from the artist and since we do know pretty widely that this is what was going on in her life while she was writing this album, it's hard to separate these two instances from it. And I'm doing my best not to make any moral judgments, but I don't know, it feels a little, I don't know, discursive at best to be like, I was just in a bad place doing bad things. Like, I'd love to see some ownership, like ownership of what's happened here. Let's keep going. I'm trying to decide what that like gender swap there is doing. If it's like trying to provide distance from what's happening in the song and making it less about a personal narrative. I feel like this isn't about SpongeBob, right? What's his actual name? I don't know, and I don't care to look it up. Like, you're talking about a man, theoretically, that has, like, lied to you and harmed you and cheated on you, but they're still, like, the person who gives you life, like, the thing that gets you out of the bed in the morning. That's so weird. I don't know. I actually really like this song. I really love this sound from Ariana, this like very soft and sweet sound. I could like very easily see myself listening to this just over and over again. But I'm just like trying to figure out what it's about. It like, life, death. This is like so dramatic. And she really is like positioning herself as a victim in some sort of situation. And I want to know, like, what is the situation? What is the, like, antagonization? Like, are you a victim of a society that blames you for a situation that you are, like, only half part of? That's legitimate, even if it's, like, you did still do something wrong, but I guess if you subscribe to a certain specific kind of morality, a sense of morality, but still, yeah. Let's listen to the end of this. I don't think there's very much left. Oh. No, I accidentally skipped to the next song, so here we are. Really groovy. I like it. I feel like I never know what to do with such like overtly sexual stuff like that. It's like so personal. I'm happy for you though. You know, pop music's really hard to analyze, especially if you're just choosing to listen to it. I'm not 100% certain like what to do with this, because all of the stuff that I read about this album before it came out, all of the like snippets of interviews, really suggested that this album was like very vulnerable, very internal. And I can see that, or I can hear that in the music production, the this sound that we've like sort of assigned to like heady and internal, that like really overproduced, high-pitched, like whirring sound. I'm not a like an expert in like sound effects, but like, and especially in this like album and this piece, the word like eternal and sunshine making it feel very space themed, and that like washy sound, that's something I would never let my students get away with, something like washy sound. But this like sort of like superimposed, just like broad like synth chord sitting on top of all of it does like feel a little spacey. And I wonder if there's something like metaphorical going on there, like the spaciness of the sound is like related to the spaciness of the album and the kind of position that she was in. But I don't know that I'm feeling vulnerable or hearing vulnerability. It feels, at least this song in particular feels very generic, very generic love song, which is not a bad thing, like a song being like commercially responsible, so to speak, isn't necessarily a bad thing, but I don't know that I'm hearing vulnerability here. I can certainly understand the idea of being like super in love that you start making bad decisions, but I don't know that that is like all that interesting. I don't know, it sounds great. This is gonna be stuck in my head for weeks. I'm gonna get in so much trouble for that one. I don't know. Mean comments are good for the algorithm, so we'll stick with that. But yeah, I'm curious what work this is supposedly doing for her. I came into this thinking that this album was gonna be sort of about like a personal narrative of like trying to say her piece about everything that's happened the past couple of months, but it's not that clear to me. It's just not that clear to me. Maybe we'll revisit after I listen to a couple more interviews, but let's just move on to the next song. See, this one makes a little bit more sense to me, this like conversation happening between like, I don't know, yourself and like what you want, but what you need, between you and a potential partner, you and somebody you like, and like understanding that like your needs aren't being met, but like you still want them even though you probably shouldn't. There's been this like really big online discourse going on about like the what is that called, like the mental load in relationships. I feel like this is thinking a little bit about that, and we say like so many women aren't receiving what they need from their partners, what they like hold on, because we've been taught for centuries that, I don't know, where am I even going with this? I don't think any of this is like relevant or helpful, and I probably need to reset the camera, so let's take a break. Like, take a break while I reset the camera. We're in this position and we're hearing like all this reporting from the headlines. We clearly have an idea about what happened, even though like we really don't know 100%, even though there's like obviously been this like narrative from like the other person's like ex, and like Page Six or whatever, but again, it's like very interesting to like position yourself as a victim, when there is like so much evidence towards the other, like the, I don't know, that just like the audacity. The audacity. And then also like to say like, I don't need like it's not what I want, it's not what I need. Like, I don't need the lies or I don't need the consternation, just give me love. Like, you're not entitled to that. Like, you put yourself out there, and I think your fans have a right to hold you accountable if they want to. Again, there's like still this argument about like moralism versus ethics. Like, arguably, like, you've done something immoral based on like a common sense of like morals, but ethically, she doesn't really owe anyone anything other than herself, right? But still though, like, that goes both ways. Your audience doesn't owe you anything either. We certainly don't owe you love, especially if we feel or they feel that you haven't like lived up to well, I guess also like the narrative we've or her fans, and her audience has like set up for. Yeah, I don't know, that's really interesting. I wonder if, is Yes And next? Is that true? Is she usually unproblematic? I feel like Ariana's been in the news a lot in the last 10 years for being very problematic. Yeah, this feels a lot like, break up with your boyfriend because I'm bored. It's like one of those things that like, man, the song hits. Like this whole album, I've actually really enjoyed it, despite what I keep saying about it. But like, if this is about what I think it's about, it's like really cringy at the same time. Again, like, at the end of the day, Ariana can do like whatever she wants, but also like her fans are allowed to respond in whatever they want to if they like really feel that she has in some way like broken some sort of parasocial promise that she's made with them. I don't know that it's all that unfair for them to be like, this isn't like what we want from you. But then is that just because like we as listeners sort of like in this like glorification or Christification even of artists, like we expect more of them than we do from like normal people, because in some sense they aren't normal people. Or maybe it's like about the kind of power that somebody like Ariana has, somebody with the wealth and the like accessibility to tell her side of the narrative that other people don't, that it's very difficult to see like perceive. I live near a hospital. Sorry. Yeah, it's like very difficult to perceive like sort of wrongdoing from somebody who you feel like has really no excuse to. But I don't know, it's like very cringy. Like you hear it in this song, like, I know I shouldn't do this, but I'm gonna anyway. Yeah. That particular line just feels really gross. I can't wait to try him like he's an object to be consumed is very weird. But like, also it's very weird for me to hear, but then that also comes back to like this like issue of gender in this industry, because heaven knows like 1,001 men have written songs about like objectifying women and seeing them as like toys to be played with. But it wasn't okay then and isn't okay now. But it also isn't fair that Ariana's getting criticized for it. And other artists aren't, but I don't know, that is like really, it's a little gross. It's a little gross. She's Do you? Wait, do you actually? I mean, honestly, like, it's none of my business. For as much as I've been talking for the last hour, probably, it's none of my business and it's none of yours, but, like, do you take accountability? Because it doesn't sound like it. Unless these, like, songs are much more disjunct and it isn't, like, a full narrative, it is just, like, each song is, like, a sort of, well, sort of like what we thought Midnight's was like, right? And they're all, like, I don't know, different periods of her life that she's writing about. But that's very weird. I don't know. You know, there's also something really interesting about her choosing to use the word boy instead of man. Like infantilizing both him and herself to make it sort of seem like this situation is like a teenage love story that we just sort of fell for each other and we couldn't really do anything about it. And that's a perspective you could take, you know, except, you know, he wasn't a boy and neither were you. You were both married to other people and he had a kid. You were adults with fully formed frontal lobes and this is a decision you made. So, you know, congrats. I'm a terrible person. Probably me, you and your mom have heard this song one too many times if you've like spent any amount of time on like TikTok or YouTube shorts. And I'm pretty sick of hearing it TBH also, but like, I don't know. There's maybe just like a couple things to talk about, like this like pre-chorus. Let's start here. Hopefully, maybe. It's not the pre-chorus. I do like what she's doing here with the background vocals. Like, the background vocals are like her friends coming in to tell her like what's going on. Also, if you've like seen the music video for this, it's obviously it's like a walk back to a past music video and a past song that I actually don't know super well. More on that later. But yeah, like this, it's interesting that like, if you think about being like on set in a place, which is probably a place that she's super familiar with, having like grown up doing Broadway, and sort of like growing up doing Broadway, being 13 years old and you're like a star on Broadway and you walk on set and all of the normal teenage things are happening to you at the same time. You like have a crush. So you're gabbing with your girlfriends while on set somewhere and getting ready. And so these like girlfriends are in the back telling you like, I mean, like, I have a best friend who tells me all the time I can do no wrong, because I can, duh. Yeah, she's like my personal therapist. Move on. Yeah, but it's like, you know, you're having this conversation and you're talking to your best friends, which are like your biggest supporters, but probably not the people who you should trust for like advice on what to do. And so they're just sort of like, yeah, do it. Go out with this guy. Except once again, you're not 13. You're 30 whatever. And that boy is married. But I also like do want to think though, like what kind of work this song could be doing for her. Because obviously it's like criticizing, she is in this song criticizing the criticism she's been receiving. And yeah, there's this big conversation about her being involved, supposedly, allegedly, with a married man. But there also is like the reality that she's been getting like all of this like super uncalled for commentary about her body. And like the body shamers always do, it's always like couched in this, well, I'm just worried about her health, as if it's like any of your business. Her body is literally nobody else's business but hers. And like maybe her doctor's, but even then I like, yeah, like, and so if that's like what this narrative is about, like truly I'm just like not gonna listen to you anymore, then like yeah, Ariana, do what you need to, I believe in you. But if this Like, yes, and is, yeah, cheated with a married man, who cares? Then, like, I am not on your side. I wish I could be. Like, I'm on the side of, like, do what you need to, bestie, but also, like, you hurt at least two people and probably more, because you've lost the trust of your fan base. I don't know. This energy, though, I'm not gonna lie, of her like reclaiming her agency. Yeah. Oh, well, there you go. I was right. Okay, so I was both right and wrong. Ariana, we care because you hurt someone. And I don't know. This is like an interesting conversation that keeps coming up pretty much everywhere. This like expectation that like people in power are set to a different set of rules than we are, or the like expectation that they are going to be good because they're in the public face and they are role models, like even if they don't want to be, like regardless, there are like little girls who look up to Ariana. And also like, but yeah, but also like cheating isn't is a moral issue, it's not an ethical one. And so we only see that's bad if you have the same like senses of morals. But like ethically, she doesn't owe anyone anything, least of all, well, who is to her some like random woman. But I also like can understand why I do, but also why like her fans do. I wouldn't necessarily call myself a fan. Why her fans like have such an issue with it, because it is like, especially if you're a female fan and we're like writing this like misogyny renaissance where men all of a sudden think it's like, I mean, like read through Instagram comments these days, it's scary the kind of things that men think. And to like be a part of like a man disgracing his wife in such a way is like, it's awful. And I can enjoy your music like in a vacuum, but unfortunately you didn't produce this music in a vacuum. Yeah, it's, I don't know, it's a little weird. I hate to be the I can see both sides person, but I think I can see both sides. Ugh. Ugh. Let's move on. How many more of these do we have? Oh, how could you ever even try? I don't wanna tiptoe, but I don't wanna hide, but I don't wanna feed this monstrous fire. Just wanna let this story die. Yeah. See, this is like also a like an important perspective on this side, right? Like every single one of us has done something wrong, and I can imagine how terribly hard it is to like be receiving this kind of mounting criticism from literally the whole world. By literally, I guess I mean figuratively, because I bet my parents have no clue who Ariana Grande is or who she's dating. I mean, I didn't until I watched like Do We Know Them, the podcast, but yeah, that's, wow, that's such an interesting, yeah. You just, like, want to let the story die. At the same time, though, like, if somebody's, like, done something wrong, I feel like it's their prerogative. If you've done something wrong to someone, it's their prerogative when they forgive you, or, like, when they let this shit up, like, let you up. It's, I don't know. That's a question for your therapist. What do you think? Tell me down below. Me and my truth, we sit in silence. Baby girl, it's just me and you. That's, it's always really gimmicky when artists do something like that, like go silent on the word silence. It's like been and done. I don't know if it's doing anything for her in this song either. It's a little weird. What does that sound like? What is that? Comment below if you know what that reference is. Oh, at the end of the day, I suppose you don't really owe anyone an apology, maybe except for SpongeBob's wife or SpongeBob's ex-wife. But yeah, it feels a little bit weird to be like, I know you'll love me again one day, so I don't care. There's an arrogance there. But also, like, would we perceive of that arrogance if this was a man? Would we care that much? I don't know that I'm convinced even I would, because I'm not a perfect person or a perfect listener. Is that a threat? Like, you're being mean to me and I'm still here taking it. Like, I could just leave. What? Can't be friends, but I'd like to- really, like, knocking down the background production and just, like, leaving it to just be her superimposed on itself so it sounds like there's a lot of her. I don't know, it feels very declamatory. I don't know, I still, like, you know, in this, like, broader conversation we keep having about, like, moralism versus ethics, if you're talking about, like, if you're superimposing that your fans are your friends and that you're, like, so upset with them for treating you badly, well, you share, like, the foundation of friendship is that you share certain moral values, and you have crossed them, in these parasocial relationships that you've created, that you've engineered, in which case, in which sense, I don't really know that they owe you anything. Like, as much as you don't owe anyone anything, your fans also don't owe you their forgiveness or their ambivalence towards your actions. Certainly not, your fans don't, certainly your friends don't. And placing yourself in, like, a sort of, like, I'm the victim, it's only me. It's just gonna be, like, me bearing my own cross until, yeah, that's very weird. Theatrical, especially, like, this part here where she's, like, breathing each note. Yeah, doing, like, all of that, like, diaphragm ab work there. That's, like, an expression of technique. Very much imagining her, like, center stage at Madison Square Garden, the ingenue, it, like, after the major conflict. Which, I mean, that's very Ari, isn't it? Does she like being called Ari? I'm not a fan. I shouldn't assume that kind of, like, closeness with her. Who is you? Also, I don't think there's been any acoustic on this album, has there been? You tell me, is that normal for Ariana? I always feel like acoustic adds, like, I guess we're thinking about genre, because acoustic is probably more of, like, an old pop thing versus this, like, sort of new sound that's been happening the last, yeah, like, 4 or 5 years since, like, Dua Lipa and Charlie XCX have, like, been the name of the game for pop. It's very interesting, but I also feel like this song might work more, would have actually worked more acoustic. At the very least, I'd be interested in hearing an acoustic version. Who is this song about? This song is gorgeous. Oh my gosh. It is so pretty. I don't have much to say about it other than that I think I really need to hear, like, an acoustic piano version of this. I think it would be absolutely gorgeous. And I would love to hear a jukebox musical put together around this song. Yeah. But yeah, who is you about? Who is she rearranging memories for? Yeah. What is the fan club called? Arianators? Arianators? Yeah, who knows? Whatever. Tell me, what is the song about? Okay, well, so there is some guitar there. Okay, and that's interesting because she's now referencing guitar, but it's like, I think the tuning has been messed with. Yeah, they're putting some like weird tuning effect to mess with the tonality. Makes me feel very uncomfortable, which I'm sure is the point. Also, she's back in her chest voice. I love, like, obviously Ariana is a lyric soprano, if not a coloratura actually, but I love her chest voice. I love how mellow it is. Like it could feel too much, but it doesn't. It's really mellow. But maybe I like that so much because I also feel like when she sits down here in her chest voice, these songs are more singable, which is ultimately like probably better for your fans. If you're like sitting in an audience, you certainly want songs that people can like sing along to. But also Ariana doesn't need that because she's a fantastic soloist. So she does not need like her fans to be able to sing along to her because we're all just like gobsmacked every time she opens her mouth because she's that gorgeous. Yeah. There's that like eternity theme again. This feels the most like stuff I've heard from her in the past. Definitely, again, I still feel it feels like more like, what was the name of that first album? Let me look it up. Yeah. Ariana's first album. Is it called Yours Truly? Yeah. That was like one of my favorite. Yeah. That was, yeah, I was in high school when that came out. I want to say, yeah, 2013. So that was August 30th of 2013. It was my senior year of high school. And I loved Ariana at the time and I really loved this album. So I feel like I'm getting some feels back. This song sounds a lot like that. Yeah. We're getting more instrumentation in this one, but there's still like a lot of production clouding it, and I still wonder if I would like it more if there was like less effects on here, and it was maybe not totally acoustic but like a little bit more acoustic. I don't know, I'm a punk rock girly, so like once I can hear the like the electric guitar going pretty wild, I'm pretty happy, and I think I'd maybe like it more that way. But also, Ariana's not a punk rock artist. Even though she'd be amazing at that. Can you imagine her? Ariana, if you're listening to this, I do need to hear you cover Evanescence at some point. Just for me. No, not for anybody else. I don't know if I love the harmony there. I feel like, yeah, I don't know if I love the harmony there. I feel like they probably could have come up with something a little bit different, something closer to the like range that Ariana was singing in. Actually, I don't know, did she do her own vocal production on this album? That's probably information I could find out. I don't want to. So you let me know. But yeah, I feel like the harmony there could have been better. Somebody was just like, really playing with the effects of the tuning effects button through this whole thing, which I imagine is meant to like sort of simulate how like unstable this whole song feels. The narrative is certainly very unstable. If I was talking to one of my friends and they were telling me this about a guy, I'd be like, run fast in the other direction. but I don't know. Yeah. There is something really just like astutely gorgeous about it, but there is also something that's like listening to this is giving me anxiety, which is probably the point. For that reason, I'm not gonna keep listening to it. Let's move on. Good advice from Nana. Wow, that was really beautiful. That's giving, it's giving, is it Marjorie? I think it's, oh, I might be saying the name of the wrong song, but it's like giving Marjorie from Evermore. Wow. You know what? I think all things considered, I actually really did like that album. I could see myself, it's definitely getting added to my like 2024 playlist. Could really see myself listening again. I really thought there was going to be a pertinent, like a really pertinent conversation here about narrative, which there is, sort of like who said what and how you like restructure situations that like we all have like a perception of versus like what actually happened and like this is her side of the story, her saying her piece. But also this album felt very disjunct. I really felt like the first three or four tracks, I was not certain what they were doing, what the conversation was. And then we move into a second half of the album that is doing very, very specific work in trying to like rehabilitate, maybe not rehabilitate her reputation, but like say her piece about this situation that keeps going on in the news. And I do really feel like there's so many ways that she could have tackled this situation. A lot of very pertinent ways, like for one, just that it's like really not anyone's business what she's doing and with whom. That like there were two people involved in this supposed affair and this alleged affair, but where like really and truly the media is only talking about her. The how and how it, that's like inherently misogynistic. We could talk about the fact that the like criticism she's been getting is like probably out of this world cruel compared to what she actually did, which certainly hurt someone and like again allegedly destroyed a marriage, but you know it maybe hasn't, all of the criticism she's been getting maybe hasn't been super fair. But at the same time, there's like a pertinent conversation about the parasocial and like maybe she hasn't encouraged the same kind of like boundaryless relationship with her fans that say someone like Lordi or Taylor Swift has. Like she does have a relationship with her fans. Does she owe them anything? And if so, what? And we could all say like we have, you know, as her fans, like we all have like a perspective on morality, on what is wrong and right. And she has very clearly, like she has very clearly stepped past those bounds. But at the end of the day, she can do whatever she wants. But that also means like, you know, her fans are get to set the bounds of that relationship as much as she does. And so she can do whatever she wants, but also her fans have a right to perhaps not judge her, but choose to be like, this isn't what I value, and I want the artists that I follow to value the same things that I value. I don't know, that's interesting. Let's keep this discussion going in the comments. Thank you so much for watching my very first video. I don't know when the next one's coming because I gotta write it and then find time to record it and edit it, which I'm all still learning how to do. But thanks for being here. Share this one with your friends and family. Give me a like, drop a comment, share it if you feel so inclined, and I will see you next time. Bye.
Thank you.